everyone. If you love Kyokushin Karate, MMA, martial arts in general, make sure to hit the like, share, subscribe button to the Drew Spearian Show that's on YouTube, Spotify, Apple Podcasts. They'll be available in both video and audio format. I would like to say thanks to a few supporters. First in Chick Fighting Fitness, then Kyokushin Karate Boucherville, Karate Joanne Fournier under the IKO Nakamura organization. You're looking to get in shape. IKO Nakamura in Quebec is quickly growing. We're also growing fast in North America. If you're in the West Coast with Shian Tats Nakamura and Great Association. There's a lot of great associations out in North America and in Kyokushin in general. IKO Nakamura is one that really accepts everyone from all walks of life, no matter your orientation, creed, religion, etc., and teaching everyone to be better people inside and outside the dojo. And with that, today, my guest is a special one. So I've been wanting to get this guy on for quite a while, actually, and he's a very interesting individual and also very accomplished, too. He's a senpai, but I like to call him sensei because of what he's done. He's basically a sensei. He's also traveled the world, very open-minded. He's responsible for creating the largest online group for Kyokushin Karate on Facebook. He's the one, the only, hailing from Texas, senpai Bill Stewart. Welcome to the show, Bill.
How are you today?
I'm doing great. Yeah, how about you?
I'm still having my morning coffee from my, you might like this cup.
Never underestimate an old man who knows. It's so true.
Not that I'm old. Well, I'll modify that a little bit. I started teaching again. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you guys can tell. This is actually my living room behind me, but it's also where I teach, and I have a private student, 19 years old, and he's getting to a point where I'm starting to find out, okay, maybe I am getting just a little old.
but the knowledge is there. The knowledge is there.
Well, and there's a certain amount of truth to that. It's like I don't it's no, you know, when you asked me before about being on your podcast, and I kind of went, who would be interested in me? I'm nobody special. I think I'm like a lot of people who train in Kyokushin. People who they go to class and they sweat and they train, but they don't ever, I mean, they're not international, you know, recognition, they're not big tournament champions and all of that, but that doesn't mean that they haven't benefited from Kyokushin. And I think a lot of what I have now and where I am in life, I think I really do owe to Kyokushin and to my sensei in Kyokushin. So
amazing. Anyway. Oh, it's amazing, man. I love the humility. So I always like to start off the questions. So the first question is, as I always like to begin, is with how did you get introduced to martial arts and into Kyokushin?
So probably the first time I had really or saw martial arts or anything like that. So I'm a bit older than you. Mm-hmm. There was a real popular TV show called Kung Fu with David Carradine. Probably mm-hmm. catch it in reruns. That was on many years ago, back when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. That I used to watch, and you think, wow, that's really cool. And then I had a friend whose dad taught us a little bit of Taekwondo, but unfortunately mm-hmm. I kind of left. So it was only, but it was always kind of in the back of my mind. After high school, I ended up joining the Navy, and my first duty station, or first shore duty station, is my when I transferred from sea duty, was in at Naval Training Center Orlando, which has been closed for like, you know, over 20 years now. One of the things about shore duty, a lot of times you would have civilian employees, and kind of give that continuity, because you know the military people, they come, they're there for a few years, and then they rotate, and they, and in our case, go back to C duty. And so my supervisor was a guy named Jim Swanson, and Swanee to his friends, and he taught a karate class at the gym on the base every day, 5 days a week at lunch. And we'd be sitting in the break room, and he'd say, hey, you ought to come down and work out with us. And so finally one day I did. And I just ended up getting hooked. And it's like, I won't say that it was in the very beginning, but within a few months, I mean, I started getting to a point where it was like, I just started getting more and more into it. And it's, I think that's what happens. Like the more you learn, the more you want to learn. And so anyway, it turned out it was Kyokushin. And so in many ways, Kyokushin is really the only style that I've really trained in. I mean, I've worked with other people from other styles, but I've always considered Kyokushin to be my core system, and anything else that I've learned, that's just something I'm bringing back. So as we used to say in the military, it's more tools for the toolbox kind of thing.
Amazing. That's really interesting how like it started with one. And I can relate, since I started with Taekwondo and then I transitioned into karate right after.
Right. And the Taekwondo thing, I mean, that was really only just a few weeks. I mean, my recollection, I was a teenager. And, we started with some basics, you know, the usual stuff, punching, blocking, you know, that kind of stuff. And, I mean, Taekwondo is a striking art. And, of course, Taekwondo, if you look back at the history, of course, there's Korean influences, but it's really based on Shotokan. Mm-hmm. Because of the Japanese occupation back in the early 20th century. So a lot of similarities.
Yeah, that's why there's a lot of blitz in, blitz out that you would see in Shotokan.
Exactly. And it's really a different approach, I think, when it comes to the fighting, the sport aspect between Shotokan. And I think there's a place for both. I think there's a different approach, you know. Sosai talked about, you shouldn't be ignorant of other martial arts, and I think that's very true. And you look at his own background, and he had trained not only in Kenpo in Korea, and then when he went to his sister's farm, that's where he started when he was nine. But he had also trained in Taikin, and he had some training in Western style boxing. And of course, Sean Cameron Quinn tells a story about when he decided to take up judo and showing up and getting choked out. But he understood enough about the basic principles that he eventually was successful in not getting choked out. And he basically had to earn his way into that. And that's a very traditional thing, I think. And in some ways, I think you have a lot of commercial schools, and it's not a criticism, because you got to pay the bills. And if you can't pay the bills, then it's hard to keep teaching. But it's a different. It's a whole different thing. I think part of the reason I really enjoy, or have been enjoying teaching now, is I don't need the money. it's very clear, and I just have a private student. I understand the obligation and the amount of work that's involved if you're going to have a big school and all that. And I found I actually enjoyed doing private, because you can focus all your attention on that person. And, but it has to be the right student. And sorry, you were going to say something.
No, I definitely agree where it's like, you got it. It really, the matchmaking of like, because not everyone, because the problem is we see is especially is a lot of people will just go to the nearest dojo because they feel it's convenient for them. But sometimes you have to do your homework. For example, where I live in Quebec, I'm in Montreal. It's an island. My dojo's in Boucherville. It's in this, what we call the South Shore of Quebec. So it takes an hour or so to get there. But luckily, you know, when I get off at the metro stop, the subway stop in that part, I have someone like one from the dojo that's always willing to pick me up because they're like, hey, you know, we don't want you quitting. We want you coming. So it's really about the quality and making sure you match with the sensei Xian, because you might like that Xian or you might not even, because it's just not a good fit. And that's where I really agree with you on.
Right. And I didn't appreciate it as much at the time as I did later, but I was just very, very lucky that I ended up in Kyokushin and I ended up with the sensei that I ended up with. Because like you just said, it's like, how do most people choose a dojo? The one that's most convenient. And that's just the reality. And that kind of carries over too in some of the politics that I see sometimes, especially in social media. And I go, why are you guys arguing and fighting? I mean, what are you going to accomplish? Or are you think that you're actually helping someone, or you're, I don't think that you are. I think most people, they just go to the closest dojo and they have to have a little bit of experience, because most people don't take the time to check things out and they don't know what they don't know. It's only later after you have experience that you're able, to do that. But then the other thing I see is who appointed anyone as the arbiter of who's legitimate and who isn't. I mean, how do you determine that? I mean, how do you, you know, what is Kyokushin? I mean, what is it really?
It's so true.
Right. And Xian Cameron Quinn talks about how Sosai used to talk about that it's not Kyokushin karate, it's Oyama karate, it's Cameron karate, it's Drew karate, it's Bill karate. It's like, and it's true, it's like you have to be very strict when you're learning Kihon and basics, but as you grow and as you learn more, you start to really develop your own style. And that's as it should be, because we're all individuals and we're all people, but we have to have the tools first.
Yeah.
And I saw my own style of fighting evolve as I got older. And, you know, when I first started in Kyokushin, it was all about, you know, punching and kicking. And then as I got older, I started going more towards, let me get my hands on you. And because I came up in a dojo and my sensei is very old school. He had trained in Japan. He had started, he started with Kung Fu when he was a kid living in Miami. And then later on, when he was stationed in Pensacola, after he joined the military, he had gotten to, I think, brown belt in Taekwondo. Then he switched to Shotokan, got his black belt in Shotokan. And then he tells the story, he used to tell the story about, basically he got mugged on the street. And, said he hit this guy a bunch of times, but he's pulling it because that's how you train in Shotokan. You train all that control. And, so he hit the guy a few times, but he still ended up basically getting shit kicked out of him. It happens, right? And he went and talked to his teacher. His teacher sent him to a Kyokushin dojo. Mm-hmm. And then he talks about, showing up there and put on a white belt, but he trained with the black belts. Because, you know, a lot of our kata come from Shotokan. And but he used to tell a story about his first experience, fighting in the Kyokushin class. And he said this guy grabbed him. He threw a kick. The guy grabbed his leg and was walking him around the mat, pounding him. You can't grab and all that kind of stuff. Like you have a knockdown. That was not the way it was in the dojo. Of course, this is back late 60s, early 70s, I think. Mm-hmm. And he say finally, the only way he could get away from, he grabbed the guy by the head and headbutted him. And that was okay. And, I came up in a class that you could grab people. I remember when I started, I remember sparring with him when I was first learning, him grabbing me by the arm, me trying to punch him with my other hand, and him blocking my punch with my arm. And he's like, what are you going to do? This is what happens in real life. People grab you and hold on to you and hit you. People punch you in the face. People will kick your feet out from under you and stomp on you. We didn't stomp on people, but you know what I'm saying? We could sweep people. We could throw people. One of the things we all learned as beginners was how to fall. Mm-hmm. And that's something I don't necessarily always see some places. Mm-hmm. He used to say about knockdown, he would say that anytime you take a martial art and you turn it into a sport, you weaken it. But that doesn't mean that there's no value in competition.
No,
because there is, because you have a rule set. So you have weakness in a sense, because there are techniques that you can't use because it's a competition, but you're still able to test yourself against a resisting opponent. Mm-hmm. And we had a rule in our dojo. You could not be promoted to green belt until you had competed in an open tournament. It didn't have to be a knockdown tournament. It could be a point tournament. The point was that you had to face someone that you didn't know. You know, there's a difference between, sparring in the dojo with your friends, who you kind of have this knowledge inside that they're not really going to hurt you. They're only going to hurt you a little bit. They're not really trying to knock you out. I mean, accidents happen, but you feel more confident. Now get put into a situation where you don't have that confidence, and you don't know what's going to happen. And it's true. It's like my first tournament. I got the impression, when I thought about it later, he wasn't too happy about it. But if you didn't win in a tournament, he would just tell you, train harder. Mm-hmm. Take what happened and work harder. So I'm in the white belt division, and which included white and yellow belt there. And the first guy that I fought in my first fight in my first tournament was a former boxer. Black belt level with his hands. He hit me in the ribs with a hook so hard that I could not sleep on my right side for a month. So, but there are two things that you can do. You could quit, say, no, I don't want to deal with this. It's too much pain. Or you can take that and use that energy and train harder. And that's what I ended up doing. And I got to a point where I was just fanatical. I mean, I went 5 days a week to his class that he had at lunch, which was a 45-minute class. And then I went 3 days a week. He had a Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday class that I also went. The Tuesday, Thursday were evening, and then Saturday class. And I just and then I trained at home, and I was just, you know, I just I was hooked, and so I went really hard, and somehow or another I end up where I am today.
Happens. So the next thing I want to ask is, because obviously, you know, it's the what I want to ask is, because you're in the USA, it's so big, the USA, it's like Canada too, but you just have more people than us. You're a population of now about like 300 million, and we're just a population of 36 million up here.
Right.
But what is the, like in the USA, who is the Kyokushin community in the USA? And what is the growth been like down in your neck of the woods?
It's crazy. The U.S. is so big, and it's only, I think, being spread out. You know, people often ask why Kyokushin is not bigger in the U.S. In certain areas, it is. Like if you go all through the Northeast, there's a lot of Kyokushin in that area. And but you know, you look back, Sosai sent Tadashi Nakamura, who ended up splitting away, and then later on he sent Shigeru and Yasuhiko Oyama, and they ended up splitting away, and we were actually under them for a while, and my brown belt certificate is signed by Seiko Shihan Shigeru Oyama, well, Soshu Oyama, because that was later. I knew him as Seiko Shihan, and he was all the stories you heard about him, they're true. I mean, he was a hard man. I didn't see him again later in life, and I heard that I've heard from people that he mellowed quite a bit, but just amazing. And Shihan Y, we called him Shihan Y. Nobody could pronounce Yasuhiko, but we called again, just amazing. And if you looked on my Facebook, I mean, there's pictures with Shihan Y, my sensei, and he used to come down, and you know, he'd do seminars. We would go up to Alabama, I mean, it was an interesting experience. But my sensei, he was hard. I mean, it's what you kind of expect from traditional Kyokushin. I mean, there was lots of drill, lots of work, strong emphasis on Kihon, and just bang, 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 bang. And, of course, we were all young. Most of us were in the military. We loved to fight. And we would do that. But if he thought we were starting to look sloppy, he would make us go back to doing Kihon again. And then the other thing, though, was that he really emphasized that if to be a Kyokushin or to be a martial artist meant you needed to be balanced. Mm-hmm. It's like you go to some places and there's a huge emphasis on fighting. And yes, fighting is part of it, but so is kata. And he really pushed that. And Kyokushin is not particularly known for kata. And, I competed, and again, I didn't compete in these big national tournaments, international tournaments, all this stuff. I'm just a guy. That's it. Mm-hmm. But I competed in local tournaments and a lot of point tournaments and things like that. And one of my friends, Ron Grant, who's Goju guy, and he had a series, a tournament series that he ran called Central Florida Challenge, four mm-hmm. tournaments. And so and I competed in that, and at the end of the year you would get points depending on how you play. So at the end of the year I was ranked number one heavyweight fighter, but what I was more proud of was I was ranked number four in kata, mm-hmm. because kata was Kata was more difficult. Kata was harder. So, but again, balance. And then the other thing I think I got from him was this whole understanding of being a scholar. It's like reading, you know, he would give me books to read. And it's funny sometimes when I think about my relationship with the student that I have now, because I'm my personality is different, but mm-hmm. at the same time, I'm doing a lot of the things that he did. And so you pick these things up from your teacher.
Mm. That's and then also too, you have, like, you're an IFK, but there's also Khan as well, who does a lot of work with IFK. So you have like Tom Callahan, who's basically the chairman of USA, and then
right.
you have like it's like and you have in your side you have Sean Schenker. There's also David Monaco, and there's like Sheehan Dave Monaco, there and Gregory
Mike Monaco.
Yeah. It's yeah. I get there's so many names that you forget, so it's like
right.
You can forget, but yeah, she had Mike Monaco. So there's a, like, do you feel collaboration is also important between the two organizations?
I think that when we get too caught up in politics,
yeah,
it hurts all of us.
Yeah,
and Sean Monaco, he's very, very open. You know, he's the founder of USA IFK. And we're kind of jumping around a little bit. I haven't even told how I ended up in IFK yet, but he's very happy. It's like when Kyokushin Khan had their tournament in Florida this year. Mm-hmm. I actually went to Florida and helped out with the judging and all of that, and just went there to support. And I'm sure when we are having our tournament, we have a tournament coming up November 12th in Holly, New York, 30th annual. It's actually a 30th tournament. We missed the last couple of years because of COVID, but but we're back. That's the longest running tournament in North America, I think, right now. I think we do need to help each other out. I think we need to be able to put politics aside. And mm-hmm. One of the things I really appreciate about Sean Monaco is IFK in the U.S., it's not like we're not out trying to recruit people or anything. Of course, if we, you know, if people are interested, we're happy to talk to them. But it's really, people should do what's best for them and what's mm-hmm. best for their students. And it's like some of the controversy that you hear about when organizations split or people go away. And I was having a conversation with someone about that. And I said, do you know, it's just politics. I mean, what does it have to do with us? When it's all said and done, whatever our teacher does, that's what we're going to do. Most of us aren't, you know, we're not high enough on the totem pole that we are going to, you know, go join a different organization than our teacher. Mm-hmm. If you're a brown belt, or say you're a shodan or a nidan, maybe even a sandan, and there's a split in an organization, what will the sandan do? You know, will they go with the new organization, or will they stay with the old organization? Now they might, because they might have enough contacts, mm-hmm. but more than likely they're going to follow their teacher, because there's this whole thing about personal loyalty, mm-hmm. and you follow your teacher, whatever they decide. It's like when Shigeru Oyama split away to form World Oyama. You know, I was I was at the door when they had the meeting at my sensei's house, and they went around the table and had a vote. And my teacher was the only one in the room that voted to stay with Sosai. And he always told the story later when he would talk about it. And he wasn't, he was very even keeled. He wasn't somebody, but he was slightly annoyed, I think, because he said he had it at the house at the Sayonara party after a tournament. And when, you know, our school that sponsored the tournament voted not to leave and followed them, he said people felt uncomfortable after that. And he said it kind of put a damper on the party. But, you know, we stayed with Sosai. And then, of course, Sosai passed away in 94. But anyway, sorry. I may have mentioned I'm ADHD. My mind jumps all over the place.
It's okay. We don't judge. It's good. No, it's really good, the stories, to say what happened so people can understand why things are the way they are. Taking it to the next question. So, you know, there's a lot of groups on Facebook for Kyokushin. It's like, I think it's like I had to leave a few of them because like I just can't with all the updates and all the posts. You have right. The largest online one. So what went into inventing that? Like, did you expect it to grow as fast as it did?
So that's a good question. And it kind of gives me an opportunity to kind of talk about that. It's like, why did I, there's so many groups. Why did I decide to create a new group? It was a very specific thing. One of the groups, I'm not going to say which group it was, but they were having this big, like, this person, we're not going to support this group kind of, you know, organization. And I was just so disgusted. I'm like, well, here, let me back up a little bit. Let me tell you a story. So, in 1996, and we were all, this 2 years after Sosai passed away, we're all still under IKO and Kancho Matsui. And I went to Hawaii to Shihan Bobby Lowe's annual seminar that he used to do, the Goshin Jitsu thing that he would do for a week. Mm-hmm. And I went with Shihan Bill Richards from IFK. And again, I'm jumping ahead. I'm kind of passing some things, but my sensei, basically, you know, he had some health issues and he wasn't teaching anymore. So I looked around and basically talked to a few different people. And one of the people I talked to was then sensei Bill Richards, who's now Shihan. And we had a good conversation on the phone. So I went up to train with him in New York. And I've always said it was kind of like an interview. He was interviewing me and I was interviewing him. And we were trying to figure out if we were a good fit. And it turned out that we were. And I discussed all of this stuff with my sensei, you know, as I was trying to decide who I was going to go with after Sosai, because he had stopped teaching. Sosai passed away. Big mess. So we ended up had a good fit, and you know, I would go up there and train sometimes. Occasionally, he would come down to Florida, and we'd do a seminar with my students, and we really jumped ahead. It's like I've jumped all the way past my black belt, past my Nidan, past when I started my school, but. Anyway, I ended up going to Hawaii. And so at the Sayonara party, I had an opportunity to have a, it just kind of happened. I ended up being alone with Shihan Bobby Lowe. And I don't know what had just happened. Something, I think. But right out of the blue, he said to me, don't ever get involved in politics. Just focus on the training. And then he made a second comment or another comment. And it was more to himself than to me, but I'll always remember this. He said, but I seem to get dragged into it, whether I want to or not. And think about who he was, the original Uchideshi, the first Kyokushin branch outside of Japan. Someone who had been with Sosai since the mid-50s. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I mean, think of it. At that time, they had probably been together 40 years or close to it. I mean, mm-hmm. before there, it was kind of like when it was still Oyama Dojo. I mean, they met when Sosai first started making his trips, to abroad. So, so that always stuck with me. So I'm in this group and I'm thinking to myself, my God, I mean, really, why are we fighting with each other? What would Sosai think about this, that we're all just fighting with each other? Why are we not able to get along with each other? To me, it was all about too many egos. Now, I'm not talking about people who really are fakes, because there are those people out there that, and we both know about them. Mm-hmm. But it's like to say that someone is not really Kyokushin, even though they trained in Kyokushin when Sosai was still alive, and either they were a branch chief or they trained with someone who was a branch chief. But it's like, it's a slippery slope. At what point does someone not, can't be called legitimate? And I'm just like, look, why are we so worried about what other people do? Why don't we just focus on ourselves? Mm-hmm. Why don't we just focus on making ourselves better? Why don't we focus on the things that Sosai brought to us? If you read the things that he wrote about Kyokushin, I mean, it was so much more than just a sport or learning how to fight, self-defense. It was ultimately, it's about character, and it's about developing ourselves spiritually. Mm-hmm. And when I see people who are fighting with each other, and I go, like, seriously? And social media, it almost promotes this. People feel nice and safe. They will say things on social media that they would never say to somebody's face. And there are no repercussions. It's not like you're going to reach through the screen and grab them by the throat, because they wouldn't do that in person.
It's the same thing like with my job. Like when you start like talking at someone, like I just tell them, like, is this something you'd say to me, like if we were in person? And then they make them realize, like, to take a step back.
Right. Exactly. So I created this group, and in my mind I said, we're not going to allow politics. And I understand there are two theories and about growing social media. And one of those is that, all this fighting and arguing and negative crap, it attracts a lot of attention and it affects the algorithm. And so it gets your numbers up. And so when you get your numbers up, you get, and there's a certain amount of truth to that. But mm-hmm. the other way is for people to be positive, inspirational. And that is also something that people, we don't see enough of that. We really don't. And Tom Callahan, he and I were having a conversation about that, and he mentioned that, and I'm like, exactly right. Mm-hmm. And so I created this group. So what do I have with my own group that I don't have if I'm just a member of a group? the ability to take action. So at the time I created the group, I never really thought about it being where we are now. I mean, we just turned 2 years old this month, and we're 49,000 members. The next group behind us, I started kind of looking because I was curious. They have 10,000 less members than we do, and they've been around for over 10 years.
Whoa.
Right? So what's the thing that sets us apart? So we're not 100%. We don't always get it right. And there are things that get in sometimes that don't get caught. And I don't really like to delete posts and comments, but I do sometimes. And then sometimes things will slip by and they'll end up being a whole big discussion. And if somebody else has already weighed in, sometimes I'll just let it go. I'll let it stay and I'll go, well, just let it die on the bottom.
Yeah.
Sometimes I'll actually turn off commenting. I'm like, we don't need to keep having this fight.
It's a timeout. It's like a social media timeout until people cool their heads.
You know what my role really is? I'm the chief referee. I decide. but if somebody is very rude or very obnoxious, and it depends on who they are and circumstances and all of that. But if somebody is just getting, they're gone. Mm-hmm. I'm like, I can't do anything to them. And there has to be consequences. There's no reason to put up with it. Why do you need to be rude? And then, but people try to use the group for different things. Sometimes you get people and they're trying to promote their school or organization or whatever. And so we allow that to a point, but only to a point. We don't allow direct advertising to try to recruit people to an organization. I've said that, everybody makes their own choices and you have to respect mm-hmm. that. And everybody knows who's out there, and if they're not happy with who they're with, well, they know where you are. So why do you need to come on, in the group and try to recruit? Put a stop to that. I don't like the arguing and all of that, because a lot of times you're arguing over nothing. Mm-hmm. It's like you're saying, oh, that's not a good technique or whatever. Well, my attitude is kind of like, if it's bad, get rid of it. You don't have to get on there and make a big deal out of it. Just let it go. Either if it's a poor quality post, delete it.
Mm-hmm.
If it's just a disagreement, come on. Seriously? If somebody's teaching, puts a video up and they're working a combination, and you get people who'll go, oh, well, that block could have been just a little bit different, or that kick wouldn't have been, and you sit there and you go, well, what you see a lot of times, you look at the person who's making the comment and you go, well, who are you? I mean, somebody you never even heard of. And you go look at their page and you go, and they might be criticizing someone who's been in Kyokushin for 30, 40, 50 years. So most people in the group don't see those comments though.
And yeah, no, it's like that with my podcast too. Like I had something saying, you should do this. And it's like you haven't done this. You're just you're on the sidelines for a reason. I don't say it that way, but it's like I just let it go in one ear and out the other. Like when some say, oh, you should do this, and you should like come support this. It's like okay, thanks for the notice, thanks for the message, and it's like it doesn't mean I'm gonna do it. Like you got like the one thing I do, like to quote Joe Rogan, is don't pay attention to the comments. Like. at all. Like, I do, like, for example, when I post like my episodes that are Kyokushin based in the group, and by the way, I'm not here to recruit others to my org or whatever. I just post, I'm just putting it on the record here.
Right.
So it's like, I'm just here to promote my podcast. If you like the episodes, great. If not, also great. I mean, like, for example, like I used to say the show that's 80% combat sports, 20% everything else. And it's always the fighting episodes that do the best. So I've just stuck right. to the, I'm just sticking to my niche now. So it's, but it's like, so that's how it is. But I'm just here to promote my show. I'm just here to grow Kyokushin with what I can. And
right.
that's all I'm here for.
Right. But I'm happy to promote people like you and people like Scott and Terry and people who are, Sammy from One Kyokushin.
Yeah.
And all these, I am more than happy because these are people who are promoting Kyokushin. They're not promoting a particular dojo or particular organization or anything like that. If you went and looked at the things that I post, I in the group, I post from everybody, and I think that's important. I think we focus. I think that we all have things that we can offer each other. Everyone kind of has their own insights because we're all on our same, we're all on the same path. We're all working towards, you know, making our way up the mountain. Maybe wrong. Same path is not exactly the right way to put it, but we all, I think a lot of us have very similar goals, and or at least I would hope so. I guess some people, their only goal is to be, you know, a tournament champion or whatever, and that's fine. I love the fight. I've sparring with my student this week, and it's like he's gotten to a point now where we can start sparring. He's at, and you know, he's okay. So I'm probably old enough to be his grandfather, mm-hmm. but he's getting to a point where, the old saying about old age and treachery and all that. It's like I have all this experience, and it's not because I'm faster. It's because I read better because I have the experience. But he's getting good enough to where he's landing stuff, and. Which is where I want him. And I tell him, I'm like, you're going to be better. You're going to be better than I ever was. And I believe that. He's an excellent student. You know, he works very hard. And it's what we as teachers, and you know how in Kyokushin, they often say how many people, out of 100 will ever make it to black belt? And of those, how many go past first degree? And it's true. You sift through all of these students to find the ones that are those little gems that you're looking for. The ones where you go, okay, this person is really worth my time. And I don't want to make it seem like that other students are a waste of time, because they're not. Because whether you train for a short period of time or for a long period of time, I think that there are benefits that you're getting from the training that are going to carry over into your life. And I started training late 1980. It took me almost a year to earn my green belt. I kind of skipped through a few there. And then it was another almost year and a half before I got to brown belt. And then it was another. So I didn't earn my Shodan until 86. Mm-hmm. And then another almost 3 years before I earned my Nidan. So I didn't just exactly rush through the ranks. This is one reason I thought, okay, I'll go ahead. It's like I get messages all the time, and they almost invariably, people who don't really know me, they'll say, "Us Shihan," and I'm not a Shihan. Because my last grading was in 1989. So, and it was for Nidan. And I had started a school in Florida. I was teaching at the community college. So I'd gotten out of the Navy in 86 and went back to Florida because my sensei was there. I ended up living with him for about a year and training. Mm-hmm. And he would tell me, go do this. Anything he told me, I went, you need to go out and you need to run this far every day. You need to go out and do this much on the back. I mean, he would just tell me. I mean, he had a canvas bag at his house. My blood is all over the bag. But eventually everything toughened up, and then there was the Makuwar, and then there was the training that he put me through in class. And that was an experience. But then I taught at the community college there for a few years, and then I started my own school. And so I had my own classes, and I was teaching. And then when he stopped teaching, I ended up with Sean Richards. And then when they left, IKO and Matsui and went with IFK, I went with them. So when USA IFK was founded in 1987, or I'm sorry, 1997, I was one of the original dojo operators with them.
Mm-hmm.
And that was awesome too, because I also had the opportunity to train with Hanchu or Neil multiple times. And we had kind of like a mini reunion for my high school class last night, because, well, you know, our 50th reunion's in 4 years. So, I was showing some pictures, and I have two pictures that were taken at Niagara Falls, and with Shion Monaco. The first picture is with Shion Monaco and Hanchi Arneal. And what's kind of funny is that we all have dark hair. And then I have a picture from July that Shion Monaco's in. And of course, Shion Monaco is all, his hair is all white now. And mine's not totally gray, but I definitely have a bit there. I've been, really lucky that I've been able to train with some of these people, like, you know, Shihan Bobby Lowe and Kacho Matsui and with, Hanchi Arneal and these people. I mean, there aren't many people. And of course, I shouldn't have forgot Seiko Shihan Shigeru Yama. And that doesn't make me special, right?
Right.
Because there are literally thousands and thousands of us who have trained with those people. The people who are really lucky, they're the people who got to train in that person's dojo, like, you know, 3, 4, or 5 days a week or whatever. Yes, we're very fortunate because we got to attend a seminar, right? We got to go train for a day or 5 days or whatever, but that's still limited in comparison to the people who that was their actual sensei that they trained with and came up on. So but having said that, yes, I feel very fortunate to have had that opportunity. One of the things I always kicked myself for was probably around 90. It was early 90s, and my sensei asked me if I wanted to go to summer camp in Japan, and I turned it down because I just didn't have the money at the time to fly halfway around the world. And I thought at the time, I thought, well, there'll be another opportunity. And then Sosai passed away. And so that opportunity never came up. I never got that opportunity again to train with Sosai. And so I kind of, I always had a small regret about that. It's kind of like, you know what? I should have put it on my credit card. But anyway, sorry. Where were we going?
We were talking just about like the online community with all that. And then we all went into a story about all the training you did and all the experiences and how politics was.
I'm sure you're going to edit this. I hope.
You know what? The stories help, man. But honestly, and the last question I have for you is, you know, as the community grows, because you said we went from like, it's only a year old, already at 50,000. What do you hope the future holds as technology modernizes for martial arts in general? Like what do you see? Like, what do you hope the future holds?
Well, one of the interesting things about COVID was it actually showed us how we could utilize technology. And you know, my student that I have, and I travel quite a bit right now. So, and again, skipped ahead a lot. So I've spent a lot of time in the Philippines. I lived there for a couple of years, and since I've been retired, and my fiance is in the Philippines. And so I traveled there, and I normally go for a month or 2 months, and then I come home and then I go back. And so one of the things I told my student, because I wasn't really looking to start a school, and was that I can work with you, but when I'm not here, you're either going to have to work, do the program I give you, and we can meet occasionally online. And I can look at you and see where you are and tell you what you need to work on. Well, you know, 20 years ago, we didn't have that, you know, that opportunity to be able to work with students online. You know, video makes all the difference in the world. So look at what we're doing right now. I mean, you're up in Canada, I'm down here in Texas. We're thousands of miles apart, and we're having this face-to-face chat, you know, and talking about these things. So what I think, there were a lot of online classes and things, and I think that's going to continue. And I think there can be benefits from that. I still, maybe I'm just old fashioned, I still do think that you need a face-to-face component, especially when you're laying that foundation. I think it goes quicker. It's more efficient. You know, it's like if I have a student and, you know, they're punching and their hands, and I can just reach out and take their hand and say this, you know, and it's just direct and it's quick. You know, it's like, you know, bring your arm up, you know, turn your hand that way. Make sure your knee is coming around. Those type of things. So, but then the other thing that I really, and it's one of the things that I enjoy about social media, is that opportunity to connect with people and get other points of view and get other insights. It's like, you know, I follow Shion Cameron Quinn's YouTube channel. And every time I watch one of his shows, I get new insights. I went, oh, you know, I hadn't thought about it like that before. Or you have people who are sharing drills that they do. And so you see this drill that you go, oh, because, you know, a lot of instructors, they kind of make up their own drills as they go. I mean, you're including all your basics and things, but it's just different approaches. And so I think that's the thing that we can get. And then that gets us to the group. And what does the group do? It becomes a platform, not just to promote Kyokushin, but to also share ideas and also to inspire people. And, you know, when you see somebody who's really good, I think it helps inspire people to reach, to dream, to think, I could do that. I, you know, or to want to do it, to want to be able to do it. And then we give them the means in order to do that. Ultimately, you have to do the work. Sosai would say, according to Sean Cameron Quinn, the only secret is sweat. You just do the work. And if you do the work, then you're going to get there. You just got to keep pushing. That's it. Just keep pushing. And essentially, that's behind the whole concept of us, to just keep pushing no matter what. Yep. Don't give up.
Very true. So I guess we'll end it there. And where can people connect with you on the social media if they have any questions?
So I have a couple Instagram accounts. One is at kyokushin.karate.blog. And then I have an Instagram at Texas Kyokushin Karate. And then, of course, on social media, Facebook group is facebook.com/groups/ Kyokushin Kai Karate.
Mm-hmm.
And so Kyokushin Kai Karate, it's there's another group called Kyokushin Karate. That's a different group. That name was taken. That's why I didn't use it. And then my blog, which is kyokushinkarateblog.com.
Okay, interesting. Well, once again, Senpai Bill, thank you so much for coming on. You're doing an amazing work with everything, and it's only helped growing. So as you said, you know, we're both doing great work. So just got to keep consistent at it.
Right. Can I make a little shout out?
Yeah, of course.
Sure.
Excuse me.
I wrote the names down so I wouldn't forget them. All right. Sensei Chris. You know, Chris, I've never asked you how to pronounce your last name. Bielchino. Hanchi Albert Mady. Shihan Yetan.
Solvay.
Solvay. I've never talked to them like in person. Well, Shion Gaetan I met like back in the 90s, but Jim Nagy, Sensei Sunny Huang, Shion Judd Reed, Shion Terry Burkett, Senpai Scott Haney, Shion Mac Robertson, Senpai Lily Weber, Sensei Sophia Louie, Sensei Raul, another name I can't pronounce. S-Z-A-B-O, Sazabo. Senpai Karen Orgelis. Sorry, Karen, I know I mispronounced your name. And of course, Shion Tom Callahan. These are all people that have helped me with the group. And I have my own approach. And I'm very hands-on with the group, and I probably, without a doubt, I do the majority. There's a significant amount that I don't do, but I do most of it and I manage it. But at the same time, our group would not be where we are without the help of all of those people. Nothing gets done without other people helping. And it's a team effort, and all of those people have helped us get where we are. So just wanted to make sure I didn't forget them.
Excellent. Well, I do appreciate it. And they say, keep up the great work, and always thanks for letting me post on the group my episodes when they're out.
Well, you post them. Sometimes I post them. Sensei Sophia, she posts sometimes too. I think she shares. And I think, and then of course, Jim does also. There's a few of us, we're really trying to share, and I got to say, with Jim posts more than anyone in the group, except maybe me. and sometimes he's ahead of me, sometimes I'm ahead of him. And I referred to Jim as like my right-hand man. I don't think the group There have been periods where I've just been so busy with other things, and Jim has been one of the people that's really helped keep the momentum going. So yeah, him in particular, I really want to kind of say thank you to. So anyway, us.
Us.